Good morning, church. Hey, we're thankful that you've tuned in with us this morning. And then for the two of you guys that are actually in here, actually one, two, three, four, five, there's five people in here. So we are good to go. Let us pray this morning. Lord, we thank you and we praise you. We praise your name, Lord, that no matter where we are, that we can have that full relationship with you, Lord. And we just thank you for being in our midst this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, let's sing this out.
Praise is rising, eyes are turning to you. We turn to you. Hope is stirring, hearts are yearning for you. We long for you. When we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the God who saves us. Worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna. Come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Hear the sound of hearts returning to you. We turn to you. In your kingdom, broken lives are made new. Will you make us new? 'Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna. Come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. 'Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. And when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. 'Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. When we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna. welcome you here, Lord Jesus. A thousand times I fell, still your mercy remains. And should I stumble again, still I'm caught in your grace. Everlasting, your light will shine when all else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond all fate. Will above all else, my purpose remains. The art of losing myself in bringing you praise. Everlasting, your light will shine when all else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond. And my soul, Lord, I give you control. Consume me from the inside out, Lord. And let justice and praise become my embrace. To love you from the inside out. Everlasting, your light will shine when all else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond all fame. And the cry of my heart is to bring you praise from the inside out. Oh, my soul cries out. Times I fell, still your mercy remains. Should I stumble again, still I'm caught in your grace. Everlasting, your light will shine when all else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond. Give you control, consume me from the inside out, Lord. Let justice and praise become my embrace. To love you from the inside out, everlasting, your light will shine when all else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond all fame. And the cry of my heart is to bring you praise from the inside out. Oh, my soul cries out. Everlasting, your light will shine when all else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond all fame. And the cry of my heart is to bring Lord, you're never ending. And the cry of my heart is to bring you praise from the inside out. Oh, my soul cries out, sing everlasting. Your light will shine when all else fades, never ending. Your glory goes beyond all fame. And the cry of my heart is to bring you praise from the inside out. Oh, my soul cries out from the inside out. Oh, my soul cries out. And worthy of every song we could ever sing, you're worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. You're worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. And Jesus, the only one who could ever save. You're worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. And holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. You're worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. You're worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. In Jesus, the name above every other name. In Jesus, the only one who could ever save. You're worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Beside you, open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. And holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Mm-hmm. and I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken, and I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. And I will build my life upon your love. And I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken, and I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken. And worthy of every song we could ever see, worthy of all the praise we could ever bring, you're worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you, oh, we live for you. And holy, there is no one like you, there is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Holy, there is no one like you, there is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me.
Let's just sing that chorus one more time.
Holy, there is no one like you, there is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me.
Thank you, Jesus, for this time in worship. Thank you for surrounding us, Lord, for reminding us that you are always with us and that you never abandon us. We thank you, Jesus. We pray over this word that we're about to receive. Well, let our hearts be open for what you want us to hear. In Jesus' name, amen.
Did a Lisa off the stage here. Good morning, church. As you can tell, I'm not Jackie. This is the B team. Levi and I are the B team, the ball team. And he's my audience this morning. So I'm looking to you for all the response I'd get from the other people. So thanks for being here this morning. And just a quick announcement. Jackie, as you probably know, is in Arizona. His mom is on hospice and near the end of her life, ready to start her new life. And Jackie will be back this first part of the week sometime. So be praying for Jackie and Kathy and traveling mercies for them. I also wanted to announce that the deacons have been chosen, and we will be meeting with them soon. The deacons, in case you have not heard, we had such a great list of men. It was really tough. The good news is we've got lots to call upon in the future, and the ones that we chose, the first round, were Gary Reynolds, Kurt Lomas, Eric Nolan, Ron Fisher, and Rusty Hawkins. So they will be your first deacons here at Calvary Chapel Buell, starting soon. So this morning, I would like to address, I'm a topical guy, and I sort of just trust the Holy Spirit to lead me into what to talk about. I like the expository for sure, but for me, I like to go with what's relevant right now in my life and in our times. And I got this word when Jackie asked a week ago. This word had sort of been stern in my heart, and so I think it's from the Lord, and you can be the judge of that. But I want to talk about some of the promises in God's word for this pandemic that is overtaking our globe. I'm going to talk about God's word, our final authority. I'm so thankful for this place because that's what's preached here, and that's the final authority. And we look to it for all of our guidance and wisdom. I'm going to talk about our goal is to daily walk by faith, and then how to increase it. And I'm going to talk about some of the things that are distracting us right now in this time, in this country, in this world. Call them faith busters. And then I'm going to build you up with a whole bunch of scripture, probably, I hope, not more than you can bear. But, you know, faith comes by hearing, as we're going to talk about in a minute. And the word is a faith builder. And so we're going to give you lots of scriptures this morning to build up your faith. And then finally, the last section and the longest is going to be on keeping our eyes on the prize and not the pandemic. So that's what we are going to endeavor to cover this morning. First of all, Proverbs 30 verse 5 says, every word of God is flawless. It's true. It's perfect. It's proven. It's dependable. The final authority is God's word. John 17:7 says, sanctify them in the truth. Your word is truth. That's red letter. I love these red letters now. That's what Jesus tells us, that his word is truth, absolute truth. We can depend on it. 2 Timothy 3:16 says, all scripture is God-breathed. It's useful for teaching, for reproof, for correction, in righteousness. All scripture is God-breathed. Our goal every day as we walk with the Lord is to walk by faith. Before we get started here too far into this lesson, you know, one thing for sure during this time when we're all sort of isolated, can't do our normal thing, gather. Laughter is something that is necessary. Laughter, Proverbs says, is good medicine. And so one of the funny things I've gotten, probably you too, my boys, my kids, friends have been sending me stuff. And one of the things that Jerry's in, I hope, Jerry, you're out there listening and got everything working. He's been having trouble with connecting. But Jerry Zinn gave me this little video clip, real short video clip, on what not to trust. You know, right now, a lot of people are trusting in doctors and curves and models and all kinds of stuff, but that's not where we put our trust. We do not put our trust in people. So what do we put our trust in? Can you pull that up, Savannah?
It'll be an exercise in building trust between one another. So Harrison, if you don't mind going first, step up here on this chair and close your eyes.
All right,
and then everybody fill in, and we're going to ask you to fall, and then they will catch you. So you have to trust us. I'm going to count to three, just relax and fall, okay? One, two, three.
No, wait, no, no! What not to trust in? Don't trust in people. They'll let you down every time. How many things have we been let down in the last few weeks? Things have changed. Don't trust in people. We trust in God. So what is faith? Let's talk about faith for a minute. Faith, as you know, in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1, the faith chapter, faith is the assurance, and this is the Amplified version, which puts in lots of adjectives to help define and describe. Now, faith is the assurance, the title deed, the confirmation of things hoped for, divinely guaranteed, and the evidence of things not seen, the conviction of their reality. Faith comprehends as fact what cannot be experienced by the physical senses. You know, in chapter 11, that's a great chapter of faith, and as you remember, there's a lot of good things that happen to people when they practiced and exercised and walked in faith. And then, if you'll notice the last part, there were some bad things that happened to people that did the same. You remember some of them were stoned, some were sawn in two, they were imprisoned, they were beheaded. You know, bad things happen. So what's the thing with faith? Well, faith is the evidence of things unseen, not necessarily. Can include good things for sure. And it all is good, but not necessarily everything this side of heaven is going to happen to us is good. In 2 Corinthians 5:7, it says, we walk by faith, not by sight. We walk by faith and not by sight. And we know that in Hebrews 11:6, it says, without faith, it's impossible to please God. Our daily goal is to walk in faith and to please God, to listen to his voice, obey, and do his commandments as he speaks to us. And it says that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. 2 Timothy 4:7 says, I have fought the good fight of faith. I have finished the race, and I have kept the faith. You know, we just finished the book of Acts in Bible Study Fellowship and studying the life of Paul and his journeys, and it was so encouraging to see, so inspirational to look at the life of Paul. And that guy was fearless. Man, he had one goal in mind, and that was to please God, to walk in faith and obedience. Didn't matter what happened. And you know what all happened to him. About everything that could happen to him happened. So how do we increase our faith? The next portion. How do we increase our faith? Well, Romans 10:17, you know the verse well. It says, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. We build up our faith by you listening to me right now, by you reading your word, by studying it. We have all kinds of social media now to tune into, to draw upon. But it comes from the Word. The Word is living and active, and it's sharper than any two-edged sword, and it penetrates as we study it and listen to it and read it. That's where faith comes from. In James chapter 1, verses 22 and 24, there's a couple things that I keyed in on how to increase our faith. One of them, for sure, is to read and to study and to listen to the Word. But the rest of the story, the second part, is the doing part. And in James, he says, "But be doers of the Word and not hearers only, deceiving yourself. For if anyone is a hearer of the Word and not a doer, he is like a man who looks intently at his natural face in a mirror. For he looks at himself and goes away and at once forget what he was like." You know, as the saying goes, talk is cheap. How do we walk? That's the question. Do we walk by faith? And is it evident? You know, there's a saying, you've probably heard it before, that if you were arrested today and accused of being a Christian, would there be enough evidence to convict you? And one of the places of conviction, surely, are actions. But one of those things that is a very good indicator of how we walk by faith is our giving. And in Malachi chapter 3, verses 9 through 11, I love this Italian prophet, Malachi. That was a joke. Laugh, Levi. Thank you. "You are cursed with a curse, for you are robbing me, the whole nation of you. Bring the full tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house, and thereby put me to the test, says the Lord of hosts. If I will not open the windows of heaven for you and pour down for you a blessing until there is no more need, I will rebuke the devourer for you so that it will not destroy the fruits of your soil, and your vine in the field shall not fail to bear, says the Lord of hosts. Test me, he says, and try me." You know, tithing is an interesting subject. Tithing, of course, the word means a tenth, and God requires that we give. Don't be distracted by that slide quite yet. It's not up there? Okay, I'm looking at, thanks to you guys back there, Savannah and Jonathan and Carl, and Rich and Tyler too, for all the work you guys have been doing with all this technology stuff. This wouldn't be possible without them, so thank you very much for making this happen. And I got a TV screen now I can look at. That's why I'm looking at a TV that somebody put back there, but that's not what is up there, so I have to ignore what's up there. Is that right? Okay. We're all adjusting to this stuff. I hate this stuff, but I love this stuff too, because I get a chance to share some of this stuff with you. So anyways, in Malachi chapter 3, God's challenging us here to exercise our faith with our giving. And I want to just thank you people of Calvary Chapel Buell. You know, the board has been wrestling with the whole expectation of what's going to happen when people don't gather and we don't take up an offering. And how's it going to work? You know, we have a budget of, I don't know how much, Phil, $750,000, somewhere around there. And so we have a lot of money coming in, and when people aren't here, we're trying to figure out what's going to happen. And I can very gladly announce that for the most part, we're at about 80% of our normal tithing. And so, you know, we are not out of the woods by a long shot yet. We have, at the end of the month, we'll have to reevaluate things, the board will, and look at what has to happen to balance the budget. Unlike the government, we balance our budget. And we hopefully will not have to make any major cuts, but we have some wonderful people on staff that are willing to sacrifice, and I want to thank them and also the people, you people that attend here, for bringing your tithes and dropping them off or doing it online, and that's what keeps things flowing here. So thank you. Thank you for doing that. And my personal testimony on tithing, I don't know how, you know, as I raised my five kids and tried to keep my wife at home so she could be that person in charge at home in my absence. And I didn't make a whole lot as a teacher. And I don't know how we ever balanced the checkbook every month, but we did. But we always put God first, and we always gave right off the top. And then we let things fall where they may. And my boys can remember whenever we did eat out, which wasn't very much, very often, we never ordered pop. No pop, because we couldn't afford the pop. We get the pizza, but no pop. So we had to live on a tight budget, but God was faithful. Tithing works. God delivers every time. Okay, let's talk about some of these faith busters. Now, the faith busters, what are some of the faith busters in your life? What are some of the things that challenge you, that pull you away from walking by faith, from exercising it? There are all kinds of things going on right now in our world. Fear, anxiety, worry, depression, loneliness. We're overwhelmed with circumstances. And the big one, dying. You know, the death thing is in the news every minute of every hour. You know, where everybody's watching the death curve. And how many died in Magic Valley? How many died here and there and everything? So what is it that's concerning you today? Because God cares about it. And God has answers for every one of those things that try to rob us of our faith. The first one, again, going back to the importance of laughter. My youngest son sent me this video clip, and I don't know if you can read the words on that. I can't read them, but it was ironic that in the paper today, on the headlines, I don't know if you can see this, but the headlines say, "Fears boost gun sales." And so when I saw this, and then I had this cartoon clip, I thought that was a hoot. And people in Idaho like their guns. And if you can't read that, then basically this guy's coming running out of a hospital in his gown with a phone in his ear. His sons call him and say, "Hey, Dad, Mom's selling your guns." And that was his response. And that evidently is a response of a lot of guys here, because I don't know if you've noticed, but there's no ammo in Sportsman's Warehouse. All the shelves are empty. You can't buy a gun. I mean, there's no guns available. They've even restricted buying them in some states to one a month. And anyways, so fear, that's probably not what most of you guys are fearful of, but some of us guys that love our guns surely consider that important. So, fear. What's the enemy trying to steal from you? Fear is surely one thing that he loves to plant. In Luke 10:19, it says, and again, Jesus says to us, "And I have given you authority over all the power of the enemy, to walk among serpents and scorpions, to crush them. Nothing shall injure you." You know, I have a dear friend, I've mentioned him last time, a Lowell guard, who would always say that we are indestructible until God calls us home. Now, that's not to say we go out and be stupid and act like some of these snake handlers down south, where they play with the poisonous snakes, and they get, supposedly using this scripture, they can get bit and not die. Well, it did work for Paul. I just read that in Acts this week, and I think it's chapter 28, where he went out to get firewood and grabbed some firewood and got bit by a viper and grabbed his hand. He shook it off, and all the people were amazed because he didn't die. They thought he was a small g. But nonetheless, God has given us authority over this enemy of fear. Hebrews 11, verses 39 through 40 says, And all these, though commended through their faith, did not receive what was promised, since God had provided something better for us. That apart from us, they should not be made, that apart from us, they should not be made perfect. You know, exercising our faith, it comes from hearing, hearing by the word. But it doesn't always end up the way we want it to. Surely as we pray for people, they don't always get better. We pray for circumstances, they don't always come to pass. But it does work for good every single time, even if we don't see it. Hebrews 11 or 13, verses 5 and 6 says, "Keep your life free from love of money and be content with what you have. For he has said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. The Lord is my helper. I will not fear." He says that 365 times in Scripture at least, one for every day. "Fear not, for I am with you. I have called you by name." 1 John 4:4 says, "Little children, you are from God and have overcome them, for he who is in you is greater than he who is in the world." It's a command for us to trust in him. You know, many other scriptures we could mention. Romans 8:28, "All things work together for good to those who believe." And Psalm 23:4 is a favorite go-to scripture. "Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me." God is with us, and we need to exercise our faith and look to him, call upon his name. Another fear buster, especially now with sheltering in place, is restlessness, or maybe anxiety or depression or worry. So many opportunities. People aren't used to being alone, being isolated. Finally, parents now are experiencing what it's like to be in the classroom at home with their kids. Right, Savannah? Savannah's shaking her head. "You know, I'm not a teacher. I didn't plan on this." But, you know, it's a whole new environment now. But it's good because we have to look to change and look to God to deal with that restlessness and anxiety and worry. In Psalm 50:15, it says, "And call upon me in the day of trouble. I will deliver you and you shall glorify me." That's God's promise. He's going to deliver us through these times, whatever it is that's trying to rob you of your faith. John 14:27 says, "Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives, do I give to you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid." And I love Philippians 4, verses 18 and 19, where Paul is encouraging his Philippian friends. It says, "I have received full payment and more. I am well supplied, having received from Epaphroditus the gifts you sent, a fragrant offering, a sacrifice acceptable and pleasing to God." And then the all-famous verse 19, "And my God shall supply every need of yours according to his riches in glory." Understand all the context in this first portion of Philippians 4 is that God gives us the blessing after we have blessed somebody else. There's this principle of giving again, exercising. Our faith grows when we practice giving. Another area, faith buster, depression. They're talking about the consequences of being alone. Being isolated. Loneliness is huge right now for many people, especially the elderly that are home alone, that can't go out and visit nursing homes and those kinds of places where people depend on outside traffic to come in and fellowship with them, and that can't happen right now. Being overwhelmed with things, losing a job possibly, the unemployment rate, you've heard the numbers. I don't know what it is today. It's over 20, 20 million Americans have lost their job, and it's going up fast. Being overwhelmed can be a fear buster, for sure. I remember, probably 5 or 6 years ago, I was elk hunting, archery elk hunting up north, and was wrestling with some physical issues and had thyroid issues and some unknown causes of some infection in my jaw, and just felt lousy, just felt crappy. So I went up to the hills, like, which I love to do, get away, went by myself and went to one of my favorite spots and was sitting there, got up there early, got before daybreak, and got to one of my honey holes and was waiting, and here comes some elk, a bunch of elk. And I was about an hour and a half back in, and I was probably too far away to be packing out an elk by myself. You know, I was probably 65 at that time and really feeling lousy physically. But so anyways, I sat there and I watched the first cow go by, and I said, no, I better not shoot. I'm just too far away from the pickup. And so I let the first one go by, and then the second one walked right in front of me 30 yards away. I said, no, I can't do it. I better not. Third one walked by, and finally the fourth one walked by, and I couldn't help myself, and I shot it. And I said, oh my, what have I done? In fact, I'm not kidding. This is sort of bad, but I said, Lord, in Jesus' name, heal that elk, because I don't want to pack it out. I'm too far away. Well, he didn't answer my prayer. It died. And so here I am, almost 2 hours from my pickup, one way, with an elk on the ground, by myself, not feeling good, and I was overwhelmed, literally, and just this sense of being overwhelmed and just too much to bear was on me. And so I sat down, and I started speaking out loud the word, Philippians 4:13, you know it well, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And I didn't believe it. My flesh didn't buy into it. I had a huge day. And to top it off, I ran out of water. And it was fairly warm. So things weren't looking good. But I kept quoting it. I got them all dressed out, took care of it, and got the first load out. But I had three more loads to go. So that's 2 hours each way. You can do the math. I didn't get them out that day, obviously, but I eventually, over a two-day period, God gave me the strength, and I found some water, and I got my animal out. But the point is that we have to call upon His Word. His Word gives us faith. When we speak it, we build our faith. Speak the Word out loud. In Psalm 43:5, it says, David saying, he was up and down like a yo-yo. It says, why are you cast down, O my soul? And why are you in turmoil within me? Hope in God, for I shall again praise Him, my salvation and my God. Psalm 40, verses 1 through 3, and I waited patiently for the Lord. He inclined to me and heard my cry. He drew me up from the pit of destruction, out of the miry bog, and set my feet upon a rock, making my steps secure. And here's another faith-building activity. He put a new song in my mouth, a song of praise to our God. Many will see and fear and put their trust in the Lord. Do you need faith? Sing. Sing to the Lord. Lots of times when I get down, get in an attitude, feel sorry for myself, if my body's hurting, which is every day now almost, you know, the pain sort of takes over, and you can get down pretty quick, especially when you're alone. And so I have some favorites on my computer, some favorite songs, and lots of times I'll just click on one of those and listen to it and sing. And the songs that are scripture, to me, are the most powerful. And in Habakkuk chapter 3, it says, though the fig tree should not blossom, nor the fruit be on the vines, The produce of the olive fail, and the fields yield no food. The flock be cut off from the fold, and there be no herd in the stalls. Yet I will rejoice in the Lord. Habakkuk is speaking to himself. I'm going to choose to rejoice in the Lord. I will take joy in the God of my salvation. God, the Lord, is my strength. He makes my feet like the deer's. He makes me tread on my high places. You know, sickness is a huge thing right now. The number of patients in hospitals is large. I don't know if it's actually any larger from what I've heard individually, personal testimonies of nurses and friends, and it's not actually in most places any higher than usual, but nonetheless, sickness is on the forefront of everybody's mind now. So how do we respond to that faith buster, sickness? Well, Psalms 43 says, "The Lord sustains him on his sickbed. In his illness, you restore him to full health." In that, the context of that verse, in verse 1, it's talking about those who are kind to the poor. But he still, God promises us that he will restore us to full health. Jesus said, "I would that you prosper and be in good health." And we are going to have good, perfect health someday. We're going to talk about that in a minute. But that's the promise that we have. Psalm 107, 19 and 20 says, "Then they cried to the Lord in their trouble, and he delivered them from their distress. He sent out his word, and he healed them." Notice the vehicle of healing. It's his word. We speak the word. We sing the word. We exercise the word. And he sends out his word, and he heals us. I've experienced that just by singing and by speaking the word. A whole change in attitude. James 5, verses 14 through 16. "Is anyone among you sick? Let him call for the elders of the church and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith will save the one who is sick, and the Lord will raise him up. And if he has committed sins, he will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person has great power as it is working." You know, we put this slide up at the end with all the elders' names and phone numbers. You know, and I just want to leave that up there for a second because I haven't had any calls. And I just encourage you, and I know the other elders would do the same. During this time, we can't call you forward and anoint you with oil, but we can pray for you over the phone. And that's a powerful, powerful faith builder. And it's a command to do that. Call us if you have any need whatsoever, and we will pray with you and increase and encourage you. Okay, lastly, we're getting into the big one here, the big D word. The fear of death. You know, I don't think I've ever heard that word talked about as much as I have the last 3 or 4 weeks. Again, almost every paragraph has that word in it on the news now. How's your perspective on death? It's interesting when you bring it up. I have experiences of bringing it up with family members. And you sometimes they say, "Oh, no, I'm not ready. I've got things I've got to accomplish here." And I have one family member, one friend, that you bring it up, and they change the subject right away. Death is one of those things that scares people. It can be fearful of dying. Even Billy Graham said, you know, and he preached it. He never thought dying would be so difficult in his latter years, the last year of his life. The journey there is the thing that's fearful, of course, not the event itself once we're there. But death has to be dealt with. I love John Piper's devotional that he gave. This was actually the end of the year, but he has a devotional called Death Rehearsal. Death, D-E-A-T-H, Death Rehearsal. And at the end of every year, instead of watching the ball drop at Times Square, he ponders his life that year. And he asks the Lord to bring to remembrance anything to him that he did not do well or that he needs to change for the new year coming in. Listen to what he says. I'll just read one paragraph. You can Google it. Death Rehearsal is the title of the devotional by John Piper. But one paragraph says this. I suppose for some of you, the thought of dying is so morbid, so gloomy, so fraught with grief and pain that you do your best to keep it out of your minds, especially during the holidays, or I might add, pandemics. I think that is unwise and that you do yourself a great disservice. I have found that there are few things more revolutionizing for my life than a periodic pondering of my own death. When's the last time you pondered your own death? Thought about it. I know one time at my men's group, I went around and asked the guys, what do you want on your gravestone? What do you want to be put? What do you want to be known for? I got mine picked a long time ago. Actually, I stole it from James Dobson. And on my gravestone, I want to put, I told you I didn't feel good. What's yours going to write? What are they going to say about you on your tombstone, in your obituary? Hebrews 9:27 says, it is appointed for man to die once, and after that comes the judgment. Ecclesiastes 3:2 says, a time to be born, and there's a time to die. We are all, unless we're one of the two or three lucky ones like Enoch or Elijah, I think it was, that never experienced death, they just got taken up, we're going to die. Death and taxes, two things for sure. And boy, the taxes are going to be going up in our life after the money that the government has been spending. There is a lot to talk about when we face the subject of death. How are we going to respond to that? How are we going to exercise and walk in faith during it? Our future glory is where we look. God has dealt with death already. In 1 Corinthians 15, verses 15 through 57, it says, when the perishable puts on the imperishable and the mortal puts on immortality, then shall come to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Do you believe this? Do you believe that death has been swallowed up in victory the way you're living and feeling and acting right now? Psalm 118:17 says, I shall not die, but I shall live and recount the deeds of the Lord. For if we live, Romans 14:8, for if we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. That was surely Paul's mind. He was fearless. Nothing seemed to bother. I'm sure he had his moments for sure. Can't imagine some of the things he went through in prison and on that ship in the storm. I mean, it was unbelievable. He was challenged for sure in his faith. But his words spoke the promises of God. He didn't fear dying. Philippians 3:20, but our citizenship is in heaven, and from it we await a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Our citizen, we're not in this world. We're of it. I mean, we're in it, but we're not of it. Jesus said that, told us that our citizenship is in heaven. And we are to keep our eyes on the prize as we walk through this pandemic. Keep our eyes on the prize. The prize is not living a good long life and having all the toys that we can accumulate. That's not the prize. In Matthew 25:34, it says, "Then the king will say to those on his right, 'Come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world.'" Have you pondered that thought? Jesus said that he has been preparing this home for us since the foundation of the world. That's a long time. Before he spoke the world into existence, he planned for us to spend eternity with him. And I have a feeling it's going to be a pretty nice home. John 14:1-3 says, "Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also." He has gone to prepare a place for us. In 1 Corinthians 2:9, "But as it is written, what no eye has seen, nor ear heard, nor the heart of man imagined, what God has prepared for those who love him." When you get a little bit anxious or worried or fearful or restless about where you're at right now, consider, ponder the fact of what Jesus is doing right now, among many other things. He's working on this home that we're someday going to occupy with him. You know, I don't think there's 5-star hotels out there, but I have a feeling the one he's preparing is more like a 10-star, perfect 10. A couple weeks ago, some of you might have seen the obituary in the paper. I always read obituaries because I want to know which one of my friends just died. I'm in that high risk group they talk about. Last quarter of the game, bottom of the ninth, 2 outs, bases loaded, full count, nobody in the bullpen. Well, that would be us. We joke about that at our elders meeting, Jonathan. But, we're in the last phase of our life. I am, and you might be too, as far as that goes. None of us know. But there was an obituary a couple weeks ago, a friend of a good friend of mine, Cliff Payne. I don't know if you knew Cliff. You might have crossed paths with Cliff. He was a counselor, assistant pastor at Heritage Alliance, Jim Evans' assistant. Great guy, a great counselor. Well, he came in one Saturday, he just walked in the house and dropped dead right in front of his wife. Total surprise. Not totally a surprise because he had heart issues in his family, but he was healthy one minute and he was in the presence of Jesus the next. And the family came to Twin Falls to try to wrap things up, but of course couldn't have a funeral or anything. So his son, I think his name is Isaiah, wrote something on Facebook, and my friend Dave Moore gave it to me to read. And I want to just read one paragraph that he put about his father that passed away very, very suddenly. And this is Isaiah's paragraph. It says, "Last Saturday, after hearing of Dad's sudden passing, I sat down with my sons. My 5-year-old Ezra asked, 'Daddy, why are you so sad?' After explaining to them what happened, Ezra looked at me and said, 'But Dad, why is that sad? He gets to be in heaven with Jesus. Papa's lucky.' Out of the mouth of babes. Shouldn't that be our perspective? We are going to be actually lucky when we die and go to heaven. Second Corinthians chapter 5. We're going to jump down to 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and just read the first and the sixth verse, because it talks about our heavenly dwelling. If you haven't got picture, I'm trying to fill you so full of the word, the good word of faith, that there is nothing can separate us from the love of God. And and ultimately Him in His presence. But it says in verse 5, "For we know that if the tent that is our earthly home is destroyed, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens." And then in verse 6 it says, "So we are always of good courage. We know that while we are at home in the body, we are away from the Lord." I heard a sermon one time. A pastor started his message, and he asked the congregation to raise their hand. "How many of you want to go to heaven?" And everybody raised their hand. And he says, "How many of you want to die?" And funny look, Levi raised his hand. "Good, Levi." "Oh, Jonathan too." Getting there is the challenge, isn't it? That whole thing of walking out our life, the journey home, is a challenge. But God has given us the victory. He's given us His word. He's given us friends who can pray with us and come alongside us and walk with us. And just imagine for a moment what it's going to be like when we see Him face to face. Have you thought about that? What are we going to see? Who are we going to see? Now there's a message. His presence. What's that going to be like? It's going to be wonderful. It's going to be more than we can imagine. I had, it was the privilege. It's probably the hardest thing I ever had to do. I did my mom's memorial service when she passed. Heavens, it's been 3 or 4 years now. And boy, I tell you what, I wrestled through that. It was very difficult. My family gathered. She was 90 years old, and it was expected. And she lived a long, happy life, a very miserable last 6 years. But she was a wonderful mother. And I had to do her service. And boy, it was really, really tough. You know, I don't know if I'll make through this, even now, but what God gave me for her service is what I want to give you in closing today. And that is the hope that we have in death and dying. We've read the scriptures, and we have that promise. I think of many great men of faith that went before us, and surely one of them was Dietrich Bonhoeffer. Tremendous man, a pastor, a martyr, a prophet, a spy who was killed for his faith. And he wrote this, and this is what I read at my mom's memorial service. "No one has yet believed in God and the kingdom of God. No one has yet heard about the realm of the resurrected and not been homesick from that hour, waiting and looking forward joyfully to being released from bodily existence. Whether we are young or old makes no difference. What are 20 or 30 or 50 years in the sight of God? And which of us knows how near he or she may already be to the goal? That life only really begins when it ends here on earth. That all that is here is only the prologue before the curtain goes up. That is for young and old alike to think about. Why are we so afraid when we think about death? Death is only dreadful for those who live in dread and fear of it. Death is not wild and terrible if only we can be still and hold fast to God's word. Death is not bitter if we have not become bitter ourselves. Death is grace, the greatest gift of grace that God gives to people who believe in Him. Death is mild. Death is sweet and gentle. It beckons to us with heavenly power if only we realize that it is the gateway to our homeland, the tabernacle of joy. The everlasting kingdom of peace. How do we know that dying is so dreadful? Who knows whether in our human fear and anguish we are only shivering and shuddering at the most glorious, heavenly, blessed event in the world. Death is hell and night and cold if it is not transformed by our faith. But that is just what is so marvelous, that we can transform death. Death has been defeated. The very last enemy that Jesus destroyed was death. And I'd like to end this morning with Tony Evans, The Mercy Tree. That's okay. We sing this song, you'll recognize it.
On a hill called Calvary, there stands an endless mercy tree. Every broken, weary soul, find your rest and be made whole. Stripes of blood that stain its frame, shed to wash away our shame. From the skies pure love released, salvation by the mercy tree. In the sky between two thieves hung the blameless Prince of Peace, bruised and battered, scarred and scorned, sacred hand pierced by runs an endless mercy tree.
Father, we just thank you. Lord, we are so blessed to be called your children, to have the promises that you've given us in your word. Lord, I pray for your people this morning, those that are sick, those that are anxious or restless or worried. Lord, that even those that have are facing their deathbed, Lord, encourage them with your word. Send your Holy Spirit to lift them up. Father, help us all to keep our eyes on the prize. Lord, to exercise that faith every day, every moment of every day, to remember what you have done and what you have accomplished through your sacrifice. Lord, I just think of the verse in Hebrews 12 where you tell us to fix our eyes on you. And for the joy that was set before you, you endured the cross. You did that for us. And for everything that we're going to be going through until we see you face to face, I thank you for that, Lord. Bless your people. In Jesus' name, amen.